Good morning. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So good to see all of you this morning. Just a quick update about me. I had a surgery on Friday for a labrum tear in my shoulder, and everything went great. He didn't find anything extra wrong, so no screws, no reconstruction, no anchors or anything like that. So he just got to shave the labrum, didn't have to mess with muscle or bone, and so about 6 weeks I should be good to go again. But don't, no walking up and punching me in the arm or anything. So everything went well, and so thank you for your prayers and for supporting us. Several announcements today. Sarah's not here today. She's preaching over at Mediapolis. She fills in for them once a month and does communion and moderates their session meeting. So she's not with us today, but a couple things I wanted to remind you of. We have our Wednesday morning coffee with Sunday sermon, and that's at 10 a.m., and everyone is welcome to join us for that. That's where we discuss last week's sermon and the coming week's sermon, and it's a good time, good class. And then we have our Monday morning meditation. This is a weekly gathering for prayer and coffee Monday mornings at 9 a.m. And we go through the different ministries of the church and through the different membership roles, or we go through the membership roles, and we're alphabetically praying for groups of folks through the roles. And then we're praying for different ministries each week and sending out little notes and cards. And so that takes place on Monday morning. And then we have our Game Day and God class. And this is a four-week class that started last week. And so this will be the second week. It's not a cumulative build class. So if you weren't there last week, you can come this week and just pick right up where you are. We're going to talk, we're going to hear a motivational speech from Peyton Manning today. So if you're a Peyton fan, this would be a good class to be a part of. And then we kind of discuss where is God in sports, and what does it mean to grow character through sports and to do some different things like that. So it's a fun class, and all are welcome. And that's at 5:30 today. Lynn. Oh yeah, for folks with kids, there is nursery care. So because Sarah and I need someone to watch Hudson too, we need a daycare, and we're like, well, yeah, a lot of folks need daycare for. So we have nursery care for that Game Day and God class. If you're interested in coming, and you need that, thank you, Lynn. And then Wednesday youth food. Don't let our kids go hungry. Sign up to Feed the Revolution and Press On Kids. And there are reimbursements for that, and some folks have been signing up just to do the elementary, and then others signing up just to do the youth. But you can submit those receipts, too, for whenever, if you're doing a whole bunch of food, and it ends up costing, like, if you're serving caviar or something, you can ask for money back. And then next Sunday, we are having worship down in the fellowship hall. We've got some special music planned, and we're going to have a camp Sunday. A couple of the kids are going to talk about their camp experience. We're going to get a message from our camp director for the Presbyterian camp, Camp Wyoming. And we're going to be very casual. It's going to be a nice service. And then we're going to have a congregational luncheon after worship. So if you could bring like a little finger food, a deli tray, a cheese tray, some sides, maybe a cold salad, something like that. Not a hot dish. The sandwiches and things like that are going to be provided by the parish life committee. But if you could bring a little side to share, that would be great. And so we're going to worship down there, but we're also going to talk about some things about what's next for our church. That's going to be a little bit of the conversation that we're going to have around the tables. And we're going to talk about some of the work that's been going on behind the scenes with the session and then with the task force about visioning. And so we're going to talk about that too while we're gathered at the tables and worshiping. And in the sermon next week, since we're doing the seven deadly sins, is gluttony. So I figured it would be great to go ahead and have that congregational luncheon. And since it's Camp Sunday, we're also going to have some s'mores. So we're just going to do it all next week, and it's going to be awesome. So be sure to be here. Bring a friend, and it should be a great, great service. And then we've got the Windmill Dinner Theater on Friday, March 16th at 6 p.m. at the Veterans Hall, and tickets are $20. You can see Patty Madden for that. Patty, you want to throw your hands up? Yep. Kids 12 and under are free, and then $10 from the ticket is coming back to the church. So their tickets are $20. That's basically to cover the cost of food. $10 of that is coming back to the church. And this is part of our goal setting that we had years ago to create opportunities to fellowship together outside of church. So this is one of those ministry opportunities for friends and families to all get together outside of church, do something fun together, and just have a time to enjoy and be together. So we're going to do that. There are going to be some sing-along songs, some Oh Danny Boys, and some stuff like that. It should be a good time. So we'll look forward to that on March 16th. And then mission. We are going on a mission trip April 14th through 21st. The deadline is March 14th to sign up. We have to have all of our numbers into the Fuller Housing Group by the 14th so that they know 30 days out how many we're bringing. And so far, I think we have about 10 signed up, which is great. We have several from our church, several from across East Iowa. If you're interested in going in this mission trip, it sounds like it's going to be really good. I've talked to the coordinators down there. They're not just driving us up to a house that's been abandoned and needs to be gutted and saying, get to work. They have a contractor at each house explaining what jobs we're going to be doing, which is wonderful, because I've gone on mission trips where it's just been like, there it is. It's a mess. Go clean. And this isn't going to be like that. So if you're interested in going, talk with me. It's about $100 per person, and we'll be staying at a couple of other Presbyterian churches down there. And then the last announcement, we have scholarships, First Presbyterian Church scholarships. Forms are available in the office. This is for kids who have graduated or someone who is going off to school for the first time. We do a one-time scholarship for folks going and furthering their education or pursuing a degree in their education if they haven't had that before. That opportunity is coming up, and I know we have some kids who are graduating, and so your saints from the past and some of your tithes and offerings have been put aside to help with our kids and their education. So those forms are available. Are there any other announcements? Adam. And do you want to say, how did the kids do yesterday with the show choir and the invitationals and all that?
The show choir did very well. They finished first runner-up at the contest. Jess finished second, and his band.
What? Congratulations on your hard work. There any other announcements today? Let us center our hearts and minds to worship God.
Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime. No help from my friends. So, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? Oh Lord, won't you buy me a color TV? Dialing $4 is trying to find me. I wait for delivery each day until 3. So, oh Lord, won't you buy me a color TV? Oh Lord, won't you buy me a night on the town? I'm counting on you, Lord. Please don't let me down. Prove that you love me and buy the next round. Oh Lord, won't you buy me a night on the town? Everybody, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime.
Danny? as we are able for the call to worship. Greed is like an apartment fire. First it takes over your life, then it takes over your neighbors too. During our worship, O Lord, create a new and right life within us. Dear Redeemer, may we appreciate what we have and learn to desire the one thing that is truly good, which is recognizing your beauty in all things.
Jesus, giver of new life, may we only see your heart of love. Amen.
Please join me in our opening hymn, Seek Ye First. Seated. There is a fine line between greed and need. Please join me as we confess how often we cross that line. Let us pray. Lord, the list of things we covet is long. We look at what others have, their homes, their jobs, their families, their vacations, and we want more. We allow this to take your place in our hearts. We are wasteful with the money that you entrust to our care. We spend it on things that rust or fade or bring momentary satisfaction. We put in God we trust on our money, but we don't put a trust in you. Forgive us, Lord. Help us to know the line between need and greed. This we ask in the name of your precious Son, who gave us his very life for us. Amen. Let us continue to confess our personal sins in silence. Of the Lord as he assures us of his providence in Luke 12, where Jesus said to his disciples, "Consider how the lilies grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. Therefore, do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for themselves that will not wear out, a treasure of heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven and renewed through the Holy Spirit. Amen."
To the Father and to the Lord.
join me in prayer for the prayer of illumination. Thy word, O God of wisdom, is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. May our lives be strengthened and encouraged through the hearing of this good news. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The epistle lesson this morning today comes from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 and 18. It can be found on page 210 in your pew Bibles. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of the riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share. The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson for today comes from Luke chapter 12. It's just one verse. And Jesus said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." The words of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Most holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? What a great tune to hear in church on a Sunday morning. It was either that or Pink Floyd's Money. Bom, 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 bom. Money! Right? That would have been fun. Greed. That's where we are in our list of the seven deadly sins. I remember graduating boot camp. The day I graduated, one of our drill instructors said, "Everything you own is on your back." And it literally was. I had a sea bag, a big, giant, green, round duffel bag with all of my uniforms in it, all of my battle-ready uniforms and my combat boots and all that good stuff. Everything I needed to go out into the field and to live for about 6 weeks was stuffed in this one sea bag. And then I had a clothing bag with my dress blues, my other dress uniforms in it, and an overnight duffel bag with my running shoes and my hygiene gear, and then one little document protector sleeve thing. That was it. Everything that I owned in the world, I was able to carry in two hands and over a shoulder. Then a couple of years ago, Sarah and I were moving, doing one of our cross-country moves, and I took that old Marine Corps sea bag, and I stuffed it full of shoes. I could not fit all the shoes I owned into this one bag. I used to be able to carry everything I owned on my back, and now I couldn't even carry all my shoes in one bag. And I was reflecting on that the past couple weeks, and I was staring at my shoes, and what I wanted to do was to bring that sea bag up here and dump all the shoes out all over the chancel area so that you could see how many shoes I had. And then Sarah's like, "I don't know, you've kind of got a bum shoulder. And then who's going to pick up those stinky shoes for you?" But I was thinking about it, and I was looking at them, and I have dress shoes and I have casual shoes. But I don't just have dress shoes and casual shoes. I have brown dress shoes and brown casual shoes. And then I have black dress shoes and black casual shoes. And I have beach shoes and shower shoes. And I have boots. I have hiking boots and I have snow boots. And I have ditch digging muddy boots. And I have yard shoes and running shoes. And I have loafers and boaters and slippers and Crocs. Do I need all of those shoes? I think so. And I know some of you may be saying, "Well, you know, okay, he could be just a little bit greedy, and he might be snickering at me in judgment," but others might be thinking, "That's nothing." But, you know, when you don't just think about the shoes, but then think about the house and the clothes and the appliances and the gadgets and the extra TV and the extra beds and the food in the freezer and all of this stuff. And where is that line between need and greed? I mean, couldn't I just live in one of those little mini houses that are all the fad these days? In our Western culture of relative luxury, it can be hard to tell the difference between what we need and what we want, between greed and what is just a cultural norm. Like, is a functional computer a necessity? I mean, couldn't I do everything that I do on a typewriter? I could, but I couldn't dictate to a typewriter. I could dictate to Esther. Are two cars necessary for every family? What about three cars for a family of two? How much do we need in a 401k? How much do we need to be financially secure if we plan to live to 103? How much do we need to feel secure, but how much do we actually want in order to feel secure? Where's that line? And with the rising cost of living and healthcare and consumer goods, can we actually ever have enough? Is preparing for a whole lifetime of self-sufficiency, is that greedy? Is that greedy? So what is that line between need and greed? I think to start, we should just define greed. Define greed. And so Webster's Dictionary says, greed is a fondness. I love that word, a fondness. So gentle. A fondness for accumulating wealth and material goods beyond what is necessary. So there's that line. It's that beyond what is necessary. And when we think about our image of greed, the one that comes to mind is the hoarder or the miser who relentlessly acquires and then jealously guards their possessions. We think of Ebenezer Scrooge, or if you're in my generation, Scrooge McDuck, right? And you see him sitting there in this big silo of coins in a dimly lit candle glowing room alone by himself with all of this money, and he's a little miserable, right? That's what we think of when we think of the hoarder and the image of greed. And Jesus kind of draws on this image where he talks about this one parable where he says, consider the parable of the rich man whose land produced abundantly. And so in response, he decided to take everything that he had and store it in a barn. And when he had more than he could store in those barns, he tore down all of those barns and he built new and bigger barns and he stored everything he had in there. And then he said, aha, now I have enough. And he folded his hands and said, a little rest, I'm good for life. And then Jesus says, your very life is being demanded of you this day, right? Like that was the image of biblically hoarding, where he could have said, you know, I've got enough, now I can share, I can do other things with other people, but he didn't. He just said, I'm done, I'm good, I've got mine. That's kind of our traditional image of greedy, right, of what greed looks like, hoarding and possessing, someone who seeks a great amount of material wealth. One of the essays that I read for Bible study in preparing for this was from The Thoughtful Christian, and he makes this very interesting turn about greed. In the essay, the author says, we are hard-pressed to find too many Scrooges or hoarders or misers today, these people who seek to accumulate and possess and lock things away in bigger barns, or who dig underneath their treasures and bury them in the ground. The essay suggests, to the contrary, our greediness, instead of coming in the form of hoarding money, comes in the form of acquiring debt so that we can hoard and acquire more and more. It says that debt, not hoarding, is the more significant problem. We are not oversavers. We are a culture of overspenders. We can find plenty of people hiding in the greedy debt of social standards. This is because greed is a component of two spiritual problems: control and trust. Through accumulation of wealth, or consumer products, or 401ks, or Jordache jeans if you were born in the 80s, or Facebook likes if you were born in the 90s, or the latest gadgets, whatever it is, we seek control of life. We seek to manipulate the things and people around us by what we have. We do this in small social ways with what we wear, how we dress, how we live, but we also do this in big, insecure, anxious ways with how much money we have, what we do for healthcare, how we decide to live at the end of our lives. We seek ultimate control. Greed is a problem about us wanting to control things that are out of our control. To quote the essay, it says, "When we look in the mirror image, we are more likely to see a prodigal consumer in whose hand nothing stays for very long. We see one for whom accumulation matters little. We are constantly discarding, whether to the thrift store or to the dump, or even paying for our own storage shelters to store things that we will never use again so that we can get something bigger and better. And it doesn't matter, it's just get it so we can have it because it makes us feel better. It gives us a sense of control." So what this essay suggests is that perhaps we have outlived the traditional image of greed, of Scrooge McDuck sitting in his silo on top of all of his coins and not letting anybody else having them. Because greed is not simply about material wealth. It is about intangibles, like recognition. I have to have the most friends and likes on Facebook. Or I have to be on the reality TV show. Or I have to be in the spotlight. Greed is not simply a matter of accumulating. It can be about consumption and debt. That's the control side of greed. We seek to control the world around us. But there's this endless hole that comes with greed. And that's what we're constantly trying to fill, is this void that exists in everybody's life. And this void is impossible to ever completely fill. There's this myth that we can actually fill it with something. Sometimes we try to do it with drugs or alcohol or TV or even religion. Sometimes people get greedy about how much religion they can consume because they think if they can just consume more and more and more and more, that this void is going to suddenly be full, where they almost make an idol out of religion sometimes. And I think we get to that place because ultimately, greed is not only about trying to control the world around us, for which we ultimately have no control, but greed is also a spiritual problem of trust. Greed is a problem of trust. We put on our money, and God we trust. But isn't the reason that we want so much money is because we lack trust? We have to do for ourselves. We have to save for ourselves. We have to have enough so that we're not a burden on others because we don't trust enough. In our business legacy, we trust. And what we're going to leave behind for our kids, we trust, right? It really should say, in money we trust, on our money. Or how about this? We say we need more prayer in schools. If we wouldn't have taken prayer out of schools, we wouldn't have had any of these problems with kids, as if our God is so small that us making a law about prayer being legal or not legal in schools is going to stop the creator of the universe from being present in schools, right? I mean, how little is that God? Oh, okay, there's a rule. I'm not going to go to school today. It doesn't happen. But in honesty, what we say is instead of in God we trust, in this big, huge God, we say in guns we trust. Or how about when it comes to the inevitability of our own death and the death of loved ones? In that reality, we don't say in God we trust. But every action and every penny says in truth, we trust in medicine. We trust in science. That is, until we realize that, as the wisdom writers say in the scriptures, that too is just chasing after the wind. Here is the truth about greed. It is about trying to control our fate. It is about putting our trust in material things instead of taking God at God's word, which is very simple. God made a promise to us, a promise that we live through each Lent. God made a promise to us saying, from dust you come, and to dust you shall return. And at the end of that promise is this grace from Jesus who says, and yet I will be with you always through the end of the age, and that I have gone to prepare a place for you myself, so that where I am, you may be also. The message that we hear over and over that we refuse to hear through greed is that we are nothing. We have nothing. We came in the world with nothing, and we can take nothing with us. No matter what you do, or who you know, or how much you make, or how much you don't make, this life that we all live is coming to an end. But in that truth comes the promise of Jesus. I have gone ahead to prayer to prepare a place for you. And he says in our scriptures, do not cling too tightly to any possessions in this life, because this life is not about just worldly goods. Don't cling too tightly to anything in this life, including this life. Including this life. So if you've ever studied any of the wisdom teachers, any of the ancient wisdom traditions, from Buddhism to Hinduism to Christianity to the ancient desert fathers of Christianity, one of the things that they all teach, one of the common threads throughout all of them, is the skill and the art of learning to let go, of learning to not cling to anything too tightly, of learning that everything is transient. The true wisdom teachers over and over try to teach us that the biggest lesson in life that we can learn is the lesson of letting go. And when we learn to let go, that is when we truly find life. Because in that place of letting go of life, we find that life is the only thing that we have. And when we find that this life is the only thing that we have, then we find this deep, deep, abundant joy of being alive and of loving. And letting go of life, we get to grasp life fully. Does that make sense? Does that make sense to you? Like, when you let go of everything, you all of a sudden find that nothing matters except for this and that. Paul says in the scriptures, he says, when you get to that place, when you have learned to live as a living sacrifice, he says, you get to the place where you are what's called a cheerful giver. He says, you live with what is in the Greek word, an attitude of hilarion. You learn to give hilariously. You learn to give to the place where it is actually comical. Because you know that nothing else matters except for this and the relationships and the things that are so important. And so you give and you live with this different type of joy, a deeper kind of love. And that's the contrast to greed. It's generosity. It's hilarity. It's letting go. And it's living fully, not clinging too tightly. And so I thought we would close today by learning a song about having an offering, about being an offering. And I really like this song. They sing it over at the Methodist Church, and I'm told that too many times I make fun of the Methodist Church, and there's always a Methodist visiting whenever I do that. But this is one of the songs that they sing as part of their offering and doxology. And I just really liked it. And you hear echoes of First Chronicles in it, for all things come from God, and only of God's own can we give back to God. And then you hear these echoes from Paul about being these living sacrifices, of sacrificing everything that we cling to in life. And so you can see the words up here. I'll just walk you through them real quick. We lift our voices, we lift our hands, we lift our lives up to you. We are an offering. Lord, use our voices, use our hands, use our lives. They are yours. We are an offering. All that we have, all that we are, all that we hope to be, we give to you. We give to you. We lift our voices. We lift our hands. We lift our lives up to you. We are an offering. We are an offering. For that is all we can offer back to God. That is the cure to greed, is to offer our lives, our hope, and our joy. So Marlene's going to run us through with the choir, and they're going to help us sing this through, and then we can join in together with them once we kind of hear it, and then you can pick up and sing along. So let us stand and sing, offering. Remain standing and affirm together what we believe in the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. It becomes easy to give when we understand what it means to have nothing and to still feel love. May we find the generous place in our lives as we offer our gifts to God. Let us share our pledges, tithes, and offerings. Will the ushers please come forward? Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Generous Creator, pour out your grace upon the offerings of our lives which we have shared. Bless them abundantly so that they might work for the greater good of your kingdom. May they nurture this congregation in its ministry and mission. May they provide for leadership in our families and community. May they be wrapped in the giving spirit of Jesus so that we can share God's love, shine God's light, and shape God's people. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." And he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If those who hear my voice open the door, I will come in to them and eat with them, and they with me. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." Let us pray. Most holy God, we give you thanks that you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They shall perish, all shall perish, but you shall endure. You are always the same, and your years will never end. You made us in your image and called us to be your people, but we turned from you. Even so, you loved us and sought us, and in Christ your grace defeated death and opened the way to eternal life. So we give you thanks, O God of majesty, for Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who makes us whole and teaches us how to give our lives as he gave his. We pray, O Lord, for this day, for our world, for our nation, for our community, and for our friends and family. Help us, O God, to love as Christ loved. Knowing our own weakness, may we stand with all who stumble. Sharing in his suffering, may we remember all who suffer. Held in his love, may we embrace all whom the world denies. Rejoicing in his forgiveness, may we forgive all who sin against us. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray now with the confidence of the children of God, as Christ taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Most holy God, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of bread and wine. May they remind us of the gift that you have given to us, pouring out your life, giving sacrificially all that you had, so that we might live abundantly and joyfully. In Christ's name, amen. Friends, we remember on the night of his arrest how Jesus took the bread and how he blessed it, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And we say that it is a mystery that his body broken can make us whole. And in the same way, celebrating that Passover meal where there was the cup that was supposed to be the cup of wrath that was to be poured out and set by the doorpost for Elijah to come when God poured out his wrath on the world, Jesus took that cup and he said, "I tell you now, this is the cup of the new covenant. My blood shed for the forgiveness of all sins." Instead of giving us wrath, Jesus gave us love. Friends, this is the feast of God for the people of God. All is ready. Will the servers please come forward? Thank you. cup of salvation. Please join me in the unison prayer of thanksgiving. We praise you, O Lord. You have set apart ordinary things and made them holy. Over the centuries, bread and juice have reminded us of your promises. You have turned this common meal into a sacred dinner where all are fed. You fill us with hope. May this meal strengthen us to be servants of your peace. With thanks and praise, we pray. Amen. Please stand.
Thank you.
So let me be abundantly clear. Health and wealth and accumulating things, medical science and research and technology, those things are not bad in and of themselves. Some of you have been gifted with specifically those gifts to do those things, but it's how we turn those things into creating joy, into creating life, instead of depending on those things to bring us joy, using them to show the love and the grace of Christ, right? So go and practice the art of letting go and enjoying and being in the name of Christ. So go from this place in peace with the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen.